Why do you think it is special and important to have nights like tonight where we celebrate Asian achievement in the Asian community?
I think celebrating any achievement is a great thing to do. And I think that what I love about the Asian Awards is that the celebrations across different genres and styles, you know, we get maybe used to showbiz ones, but this is so much more than that. And so, you know, the science and philanthropy and stuff like that, I think are great to have those mixed in as well. And also it's Pan-Asians, you know, so that's a good reflection. It's what makes it different. And it's always a fun night. And, you know, being in a room full of people who've achieved across different disciplines is always a lovely thing to be a part of.
Can you tell us a bit about what you've got coming up 2019 and beyond?
Yesterday, which is a Richard Curtis, Danny Boyle film, that'll be out in the summer, I believe. So that'll be one of the big summer releases. So I'm looking forward to audiences seeing that. I'm looking forward to seeing it myself. I've seen about 4 minutes of it. But they were great. It was a great 4 minutes. And that was a great fun thing to be a part of. Outside of that, not a lot more this year, I don't think, actually. There's a game show that I've done, a quiz show that I've done for ITV. I think that will be out later on in the year. And then it'll be another Unforgotten for ITV, which we start work on towards the end of the year, but won't be on the screens till next year, I'd imagine.
Just going back to yesterday, obviously you talk about working with two iconic storytellers there. Can you talk about what you think makes them both such very special filmmaking talents?
Yeah, well, Richard Curtis is kind of just a master at romantic comedy. I mean, he knows how to structure it. He's very funny. He's very funny in real life as well. Danny Boyle just has such a kind of visceral vision when it comes to making cinema that it's just a really, really interesting mix. You know, there's no special effects. Or very little special effects. There's no kind of car chases or, you know, that kind of stuff. There's no action scenes. So to see what Danny would do with it was always really interesting. But he was amazing on set, Danny Boyle, just constantly enthusiastic, constantly encouraging. Great to be a part of it.
Unforgotten's been a huge hit with audiences, and they'll be excited about at some point getting the next batch of episodes for that. I'm curious, when you look to continuing that story, obviously it's a rare privilege in some ways to get to live with a character for as long as you have at this point. Are there specific areas of the show that you're hoping that you get to delve into a bit more in that next batch of episodes?
It is a privilege. It is a privilege to be in a returning series. It's a privilege to work, to be quite honest. But when you get something that, you know, you believe in the quality and just the caliber of people around you, that's a real gift. In terms of delving more, I've been really interested in the three series so far and where they went. So I have no idea what's coming up in the fourth. But it'll be fun to get back together with everyone, I think.
Talking about getting back with people, obviously it's an amazing cast you're alongside there. Can you talk a little bit about that experience for you as an actor and what makes the rest of the team so very special on that?
In Unforgotten? It starts with the words. Scripts are fantastic. There's a brilliant director. We've been lucky to have the same director on all the series, which is unusual nowadays. And the core team are fantastic. Nicola Walker is just one of the best actresses I've ever worked with. And so I always feel I have to raise my game with her. But also, she's great fun. So what's been lovely is there's been a friendship that's come out of it.
I'm sure when you meet fans, the most common question you get asked is when and if we're ever going to see your own comedic creations back on our screen. I'm curious, do you think that's something that could happen at some point? Do you and the rest of the team have an appetite to bring that family back?
Yeah, with both of the biggest successes I've had, with Goodness Gracious Me and the Kumars, yeah, I'd love to kind of go back and revisit those, maybe in a slightly different form. But yeah, I think everyone would be up for it, yeah.
I think those shows would perhaps, I mean, like you say, be in a different, would evolve for 2019, because obviously at the time they were hailed as being sort of, you know, watershed moments and landmarks in terms of changing the diversity of programming. Do you think that would be something that would maybe factor into how you would want to bring them back in 2020 or beyond?
I think you have to factor it. I don't think you can help it, actually. I think we're constantly impacted by everything that's going on around us. So in the same way that, you know, musicians evolve, well, maybe not status quo so much, but certainly a lot of musicians kind of evolve, because you're just open to what's around you. So something like Goodness Gracious Me, the satirical targets that we had 20 years ago. Actually, unfortunately, a lot of them are the same. Yeah, you would naturally evolve, and also your own life experiences kind of change as well, and you factor those in too. So they would be evolutions, I'd hope.
Wonderful to have you tonight at the Asian Awards. Why do you think nights like tonight are so special and important?
I think it's just nice to be celebrating talents from all across the country and all across Asia, and also the mix of it being international as well as also from India and from the film industry in India. And it's just great to acknowledge people that have done really well over the last year.
Why do you think it is so important to celebrate that diversity throughout the diaspora and to maybe perhaps challenge people's stereotypes and pre-expectations about what it means to be Asian?
I think because it's a global world now, so it's quite exciting to celebrate all different sorts of, you know, it's everyone here tonight, or a lot of people here tonight are Asian and are Indian and are from different parts of Asia, but have still, you know, they represent a much more global epidemic as well, and they represent, you know, the different places they've grown up in, and it's a sort of melting pot of our culture and our times.
Of course, it's such an exciting time for Bollywood, I think exploding globally more so than any point in its history. Why do you think that is? Why do you think there is this massive appetite around the world for Indian cinema?
Because it's amazing cinema. It's very entertaining. It's extremely colorful. It's very culturally relevant in India, but I think the rest of the world also finds that entertaining, that things are the way that they are culturally in our country. And just, I think there's just a global curiosity about each other, because the world is kind of becoming smaller in a sense, but also everyone's becoming a little bit more culture conscious and, you know, one-minded type. So I think that's kind of why, I don't know. So I've just moved to London, and I'm currently looking at some films to do back home, and a couple of them here. So hopefully something soon I'll make an announcement about.
When you're looking at doing stuff here, are there particular types of projects? I mean, is it television? Is it more film? Is it what would be your dream kind of project at this point in your career?
Honestly, I just like to see women in comedy, and that's sort of the last thing that I did, and it's still something that I'm passionate about right now. Of course, I mean, television is just exploding as well, and the last thing I did was actually a web series. So, I mean, I'm open to all avenues and all outlets of cinema. It really just depends on the project and if the character is something that I want to sink my teeth into, to be honest with you.
Of course, when fans meet you at events like tonight, I'm sure they're very quick to tell you the characters you've played, the projects you've been involved with that meant the most to them. I'm curious, is there one character or perhaps one project that when you look back now, you're most proud of or has the most special place in your heart?
There is, but I feel like I would disappoint everyone if I said it, because it wasn't, you know, it's probably not everyone's number one choice, but I did a film called The Shaukeens with Akshay Kumar and Anupam Kher and Anu Kapoor and Piyush Mishra. And I just, that character is so far away from who I am that it took so much to get into it. And then when I did, I really embraced it and had a great time on set. And that was also my first film with Akshay Kumar, who I really look up to and think he's amazing. So it was a very special film for me.
You mentioned there just a few of the wonderful names you've had the privilege of working alongside. I'm curious, do you have very special memories of your time in Bollywood? I mean, particularly now that you're moving back here, you must dwell on those sometimes and think about fun moments on set. Are there things that make you smile the most when you think about working in that industry?
I still am in that industry, so of course it still makes me smile. It's wonderful to go to work and come home and feel great, and I still do. I'm in Mumbai a lot, and very easily accessible, so I don't have that sense of like longing or missing it, because I haven't left, I guess.
Why are events like this so special and important, do you think?
I just think, especially for me in the industry that I'm in, and it's so diverse, and it's just, you know, these kind of events just help us all celebrate our diversity and in a way that you don't usually get to, so in a very glamorous way. So it's and they're a lot of fun, so there's no reason not to come.
Do you think that the diversity of creative talents being honoured here tonight goes a long way to dispelling some of the stereotypes about what it means to be Asian?
Yeah, I think so. At the moment, in the past sort of years, I think definitely, you know, we're at a time where sort of positive reinforcement and role models are hugely important to us. So, yeah, I think you're absolutely right.
curious, as someone who's been a big part of our small screens, how important a tool you think television is in being part of that dialogue, in being part of that education, I guess, for lack of a better word?
I just think, I mean, there's no point, when you're sort of in a position that I am, and people that are, you know, have much bigger profile than I do, I think you've got to be responsible with what you do with it. And I think being positive and just being present, I mean, not sort of pushing it down people's throats of what your heritage is or anything like that. I think just, you know, being successful and being positive with that success is basically the way forward for me. That's how I like, if I'm going to have a philosophy to my work, that's kind of how I put that to it.
Talking about going forward, you've got a great night ahead of you tonight. Beyond that, what are you excited about the rest of 2019 and beyond?
I've just recently joined EastEnders, so that's a massive, you know, it's for me, it's a really exciting time. All my stories are developing. Tonight, I just want to sit and enjoy and celebrate all the wonderful people and all their achievements, so, yeah.
Yes, my final question, obviously EastEnders is an amazing platform to be a part of, a great family to be joining. What are you most hopeful about in terms of looking to what you're going to be able to do with that show that you maybe couldn't with, you know, something that isn't on our screens quite as often as EastEnders?
I think basically the story writers, you know, they have a massive task to sort of send a message to, you know, there's a certain demographic that watch the show, and you know, there's some really important things being said with the, you know, by the story team, and it's just wonderful to be a part of that.
Well, I think, you know what, Asians, we're all from an immigrant background. I think it's, and we've lived here, we've struggled here, we've suffered here, we've paid taxes, and then we've prospered. And so it's good to celebrate some achievements, and it's great when the community gets together and, you know, just we all pat each other on the back a little bit and inspire each other to do better.
Talking about prospering, you've been prospering on screen lately, obviously Eaten by Lions. Can you tell us a little bit about why that was such a fun project for you and why people need to make sure they see it when it's out now?
Well, Eaten by Lions was fun from the audition onwards. The audition was mayhem. It was a crazy experience. It was really chaotic, and it's too long a story to tell you, but I'd never been to such a chaotic audition. It was full of laughter, and the director at the end of it said, well, that's kind of how it's going to be on set. So, and it was. And we had great characters. We had Tom Binns, we had Johnny Vegas, we had Kevin Alden, all the really, really great comedians and actors to be around. So it was great fun.
In terms of comedy, why do you think that Britain seems to perpetually be leading the way in that genre?
I think what the British are good at is making fun of themselves. We're very, very good at that. We have a very ironic sense of humour. We don't mind looking foolish, and I think some of the best comedy has come out of the UK, you know. I think it's inevitable. We're very, very good at playing fools, from Only Fools and Horses to Dad's Army to It Ain't Half Hot Mum. It's just Fawlty Towers. It's endless. The list goes on.
And I know eagle-eyed fans might be able to spot you in the new Hellboy film that's just about to open. If people are going to keep an eye out for you, can you tell us a little bit about where they should be looking out for you?
Well, if you blink, you might miss me in the Hellboy film. I only had a couple of scenes, very short, little part. I didn't expect to get a part, to be honest. But you know, when they go, do you want to be in Hellboy? I go, yeah, of course. I'd be in the background if they asked me to. And I got to work with David Harbour, and it was great. So I get slashed by some ugly creature, and yeah, it was great. And I was in Bulgaria for 2-3 weeks. It was lovely experience to be on a set like that.
And we love David. What was it like working with him? I mean, obviously under quite a lot of prosthetics, it's fair to say.
Yeah, I mean, he had a tough job. I mean, he's in that mask, he's in that getup all day. I mean, that you know that's tough. But he's a proper kind of irreverent New Yorker, you know. He's very irreverent, and you know, the little time we hung out on set, we had some great stories. So he was a real gentleman.
Talking about tough, I guess I have one final question for you, and it's a tough one that I think faces a lot of actors, which is that the question, you know, you said you're lucky to have a part in things. I'm curious how you feel about that eternal debate about whether or not it's better to take small parts, even if they feel tokenistic, or to resist playing stereotypes as a way of pushing forward a wider discussion about representation and diversity. I'm curious where you fall on that slightly complicated issue, which I'm sure as an actor you've faced on many occasions looking at many scripts.
It's a tricky one to answer in a soundbite. I've been lucky in my career. I've been lucky with the opportunities I've been given, and also I've been lucky with the choices that I've made. You know, sometimes you're there because a box needs to be ticked, and sometimes you're there because the director goes, no, he'd be really good at this part. And everything varies. It's always changing. I just hope it would change a little bit quicker for me.
Nights like this matter hugely. I mean, 9 years of celebrating Asians around the world, Pan-Asian in the last couple of years. It's been an amazing how the award ceremony has grown, not just in terms of recognition, but the kind of recognition it gives to other people that may not necessarily get the recognition they deserve in terms of the philanthropy stuff, the charitable stuff. People in the arts, which is where I come from, who sometimes, you know, is kind of the underdog. It's not always the obvious winner for the award. So I think it's really important the more we champion people that don't get sometimes the recognition that they deserve.
Do you think that the diversity of talent and achievement being honoured tonight goes a long way towards challenging stereotypes about what it means to be Asian?
Well, I think that's exactly what it's about. I think the fact is it's about bringing people to the forefront and to the limelight who don't normally have a platform to be recognised. And I think the Asian Awards does that really, really well. And the fact that it's across Asia rather than just sort of South Asians where we come from, you know, it's East Asians, it's Far East, it's everything across Asia, British and beyond. And I think it's an amazing platform to recognise people's contribution to society, but also, again, particularly in the arts, which is the one I always keep my own.
Talking about yourself, what have you got coming up 2019 and beyond?
So I am currently an associate director for Rivco Theatre Company, which is a really nice big change in my kind of career graph. I'm about to direct my first theatre show, which is based on the true story of a young man that many of you might remember from a programme called Educating Yorkshire. It was a guy called Mushy who had a stammer, and his teacher gave him some headphones to kind of help him overcome the stammer. We're going to tell the story after the cameras went away and how he rehabilitated himself. I've got a film coming out that I'm in that's been directed by Vikram Butt called Ghost, and a British film called Trendy, which is when we shot it, but I'm not sure if that's what it ends up being called, but about the regeneration of East London and how no one in East London is actually from East London anymore. But a lot of good things happening.
Jay, it's wonderful to have you here at the Asian Awards. I think it's a big question, but what does that label Asian mean to you?
Yeah, it's a great question. For me, I've always considered myself a global citizen, but thanks to my parents, I'm Asian. And for me, what it means is a society and a community that has so much potential. And I really believe we're just getting there. We're letting people express themselves more creatively. We're seeing a burst of Asians in every space around the world. And for me, that's just exciting for the whole world because we get to share our culture and diversity, but we also get to experience everyone else's as well.
Do you think that on nights like tonight, the diversity of talent and achievement being honoured goes a long way towards dispelling some of the lingering stereotypes about what it means to be Asian and the limits of that term?
Absolutely, absolutely. I think nights like this allow us to build new role models for young children of all types and all backgrounds, because I think that when young people see people in movies, people in music, etc., it just opens up their world for them. And I always say, you can't be what you can't see. So if people can't see people in these spaces, then they'll never want to be there. So I got rejected by 40 media companies before I ever made a video. I was turned down by countless execs and directors who said to me that because I didn't study communications or marketing or journalism, that I had no hope to make it in media. So I got to the point where the only option I had left was to start my own channel. And I really got to a point where I was just like, this is not happening for me, but I'm going to try this one last opportunity. And I'm glad I did. And that's my advice to everyone, that when you feel you've exhausted all options, remember this, you haven't, and keep going and finding a new way. And that's the beautiful world we live in today. You no longer need permission. You don't need someone to say that you have a voice. You've got an opportunity to build your own voice. And I'd highly recommend that everyone takes that opportunity.
I think obviously, for people who are trying to start that process online and build their own platform to make their own voice heard, it can sometimes be difficult to get it heard because of the white noise effect, the oversaturation. I'm curious if you have advice for people about how you break through that and you achieve the kind of viral success that you so often seem to.
One of the biggest things is making sure that you deeply understand your message, that you've spent time on it. I had an offline career of doing this for 11 years before I ever went online. So I'd been studying books, learning, coaching, teaching, all of these things for 11 years before I ever made a video. And I actually did it for free before I even made money from it. So I think that's one big thing. The second thing is get to know your platform and your audience. So many people are putting the same video across all platforms. So many people are not making highly produced content. If you want to make this a real thing for yourself, you have to think about it professionally. And so consistency, focusing on the platform, and deeply understanding your audience's needs.
I mean, when we look to the future of some of the online platforms like YouTube and such, obviously it's a slightly complicated time, I guess, particularly with some of the copyright law changes and the way those platforms are coming under pressure to perhaps be a little bit more onerous in terms of their censorship, particularly when it comes to comedy and things like that. How do you feel about all of those issues as someone who does have such a huge footprint online?
Well, I think it's great that platforms are taking into account diversity, unity, different cultures, different sensitivities. I think that's all good for the progression of humanity. We need to become more conscious and more awake to people's needs, interests, and concerns. So for me, the platforms are trying their best, but it's really for us, the creators, to figure that out. Like, the creators should be directing the platforms, not the other way around.
Obviously, for a lot of people, you're going to be one of their favorite creators. Who are the creators that you enjoy, though? Who are the people that, particularly in an online space, you're watching when you're not making great stuff yourself?
That's a great question. I really love what Will Smith's doing in this space. The fact that he's using his platform to spread inspiring messages is incredible. Jada, too. What Jada's been doing with Red Table Talk is fantastic. I think opening up that discussion across generations is phenomenal to see. So those are two of the people that are definitely inspiring me on the online space.
So when you meet people who enjoy your content, they have their favorite videos, their favorite pieces of work you've done. I'm curious, is there a particular video that you're most proud of or has the most special place in your heart?
I made a video last year which was for Mental Health Awareness Week, and it was the story of a young girl who unfortunately committed suicide. And that story was told from a really genuine place. The team that we had in place had actually experienced that in their personal lives. So this wasn't a manufactured video, it was a genuine expression of the heart. It meant the most to me, not because it also got 120 million views or something like that, but it was really important to me because we got to tell a story where all the number one comments are, Jay, you just stopped me from committing suicide, or Jay, you've opened up an opportunity for me to talk to my friend. And so when my videos build action in people's lives, that's when I get most excited.
Yes, so in terms of comments, obviously you get so many positive ones, but I think one of the big discussions in our society is how we legislate the negative side of the internet and those comments. I'm curious as a content creator how you deal with that and how you think as a society we should be looking to control or not that area of expression.
Unfortunately, we live in a world where when you can't see someone and you don't know their name, people have the freedom to say what they like. My advice to any creator is give energy to the people that love you. For every one negative comment, you'll have nine positive ones. And you have a choice. You either debate that one person or you thank the nine people. My approach has been express gratitude to those nine people, appreciate how much love they're giving you, and give them energy.
In terms of what you're using that energy for the rest of the year and beyond, have you got other things you're working on at the moment that you're really excited about, things we should be looking out for?
So I launched my podcast 2 months ago. It's been an absolutely incredible thing to work on. I'm currently writing my book. It will be out next year. So really working very hard on that. And then there's lots more exciting things I can't say yet.
In terms of that book, I mean, is that fiction, non-fiction? Can you tell us a little?
It's non-fiction based on life principles and how we can truly transform our experience, finding passion, finding purpose, and finding meaning in our lives.
Obviously, we've seen a lot of people from an online space writing books of one kind or another. Why was that something that was important for you? Is that something you've always wanted to do, or is it something you're approached to do?
For me, I come from a world of having listened to classes as a monk for 3 hours, and I've been having to make 3-minute videos. So for me, the book's actually a perfect opportunity where I can really unpack and go into depth about all of these concepts I raise in my videos. So for me, it's an opportunity to really give the audience and give my community an opportunity to deeply understand me and what I'm really trying to teach.
Before we let you go and enjoy yourself tonight, have you got a message for that audience, all the people who love what you do and can't wait for much more of it?
I just want to say thank you so much for all the incredible feedback, all the incredible likes, loves, and shares that I get every single day and every single week. I wouldn't be anywhere without you all. Thank you so much.
Why are nights like tonight so special and important?
It's important because we're celebrating people who, in terms of the whole history of the United Kingdom, have more latterly come to these shores, but have revolutionised the country. And not just revolutionised it, absolutely put it onto an international platform. The contribution of the Asian community is immeasurable, from food to culture to, you know, positions in government now. It's fantastic. So I'm here to help to celebrate Asian excellence.
When you're not celebrating here tonight, what else are you looking forward to in 2019 and beyond?
Oh my gosh, I'm so busy. This is my 25th year of music, so I'm proud that I'm going to be celebrating that with a concert at the Royal Festival Hall with an orchestra next month in May, which will then be for an album in September. I've got a summer full of festivals. I'm preparing for a couple of musicals next year, so life is great.
We're so happy that even people who haven't got a ticket are going to get a chance to enjoy that Royal Festival Hall gig. I'm curious what kind of songs, what kind of material you're going to be working, because obviously the benefit of an orchestral accompaniment doesn't come along very often.
That's right. I will be presenting my own songs with a orchestral twist, songs which are associated with me from musicals and what have you, and then other songs which are going to be covering on the night with a couple of special guests, just because I can.
Because you can, and you should. And obviously you said you're prepping for some new musicals next year. Are those instances of you joining existing runs of productions, or are they new things that we should be getting even more excited for?
I am prepping brand new musicals for next year, which is desperately exciting. We're at the moment we're in workshop phase with a view for full production next year. So I'm so busy and I love it. I absolutely love it.
That's my final question. Obviously, hopefully those shows will be taking place in London. I'm curious, what is the unique magic of London as a live musical theatre venue? Because I think for so many people, it is the capital of musical theatre for the whole world.
London has its own mystique. It has its magic. It has its sparkle. Our West End is, you know, it's extensive. There is every kind of show to suit every kind of musical theatre palette, from the new and revolutionary Hamilton right through to the more classical Les Mis. I was at the Jack the Ripper Opera the other day, which was incredible, and with all kinds of different genres in between. So you can come, and it's and the way musical theatre's changed over here in the West End, it's become so much more interactive, and it's grown and grown and grown. So the West End and Broadway, there is no difference. It's the cream of performance.
Why are nights like tonight so special and important?
Well, I'm actually quite heavily involved in the Asian community. I do a lot of singing at like Asian weddings and private parties. So yeah, it's just really amazing to be here and actually celebrate everything Asian culture.
What is so special, so unique, you think, about Asian culture? I mean, you know, obviously we're on nights like tonight celebrating. You're so involved in it yourself. Can you describe the unique magic of Asian culture?
Absolutely. I think the music is at the heart of it, and obviously the food. And I love my food, and I love my music. So, yeah, it's a perfect match.
We love your music as well. Looking to the rest of the year and beyond, what should we be excited about at the moment? What's coming up next?
Great. Well, I'm currently on tour with Calabro, Britain's Got Talent winners. So I'm performing with them at the Royal Albert Hall. At the end of the month, which is going to be really exciting. So I'm going to do some new material. And also, I'm part of All Together Now, which is a new show on BBC One. So, yeah, I'm just enjoying being part of that. And the final is actually tomorrow night. So, yeah, tune in, BBC One.
Of course, the Royal Albert Hall, for so many people, is the ultimate venue to perform at. Why, of all of the great music venues in the world, is it so special for performers?
I think it really is iconic to London, and it's just got such an amazing sound. A bit like that car engine. But no, it's just got the most incredible sound. And yeah, I mean, it's just, I've played there before actually, when I supported Peter Andre. So yeah, and I did an acoustic set and the sound was just magic. And as you say, it's got so much history. So yeah, it's just an absolute honour to be performing there alongside a band like Calabro, who are amazing.
Dominic, it's wonderful to have you here tonight for the Asian Awards. I guess the obvious question, why is it so special and important, you think, to specifically have nights like tonight where we celebrate the achievements and amazing qualities of the Asian community?
Well, it's high time, isn't it? You know, I grew up in Leicester in the 60s and you know, all the flux of Asians that came over from Uganda when Idi Amin threw them out, and look at the extraordinary success they've made of their lives in this country. It's commendable. And my agent here in London is an Asian, Luke Chowdhury, at International Artist Management. So he brings me along, and it's always a good night. It's my second event, second time coming. And they let their hair down. God bless, it gets very Bollywood in there later on, trust me.
Talking about film work, obviously you've got a fantastic film world premiering on Monday next week. Can you tell us a little bit about where you fit into that and what fans can expect overall from that one?
Well, this is a great film I'm really proud of. I think it's going to go well. It's called Once Upon a Time in London. It's a gangster movie set in the late 40s, early 50s. The turf war between two real families, the Adams and the Hill family, who vied for the East End back then before the craze took over. I get to play a really slimy character called Dodgy Johnny, who is the owner of the brothel that they all frequent. And I think this could blow up in the sort of vein of Peaky Blinders. It's period gangster stuff and some really classic good actors in it. It was a great script and Simon Rumley did a fantastic job directing.
I mean, why do you think the gangster genre, particularly here in this country, is one that we're so continually drawn to? What is it about this world, these types of human beings, that fascinates us so much?
They're street rock stars, mate, is what it is. It's there's always something slightly glitzy about, you know, the danger boy. And celebrity and gangsters have always messed up together. So there'll be a few here tonight, I'm sure.
Talking about celebrities, can you talk about the rest of the cast on that one? Because Once Upon a Time in London, it's a wonderful lineup, a smorgasbord of talent you're working alongside.
On the gangster movie, yeah, Leo Gregory. I don't know all of them. God knows, I've been away 25 years. Terry Stone, who put the whole thing together. Yeah, very good cast. It is a smorgasbord, as you say, and a little bit of me.
Why are nights like tonight so special and important, do you think?
For me personally, or for the Asian community in general?
Yes, for both.
Well, for the Asian community in general, London's a melting pot of different races, ethnicities, and obviously the Asian community is a big part of that. They've done very well since the 1960s and 70s when they came here, so why not have an award show to celebrate that? I'm running for London Mayor 2020, May the 7th. I'm going to take Sadiq Khan's crown. That's the plan. I've seen a lot of problems in London that we didn't have when I was a kid. And basically, the current mayor's not doing anything about it. So I'm there to change that. Homelessness, crime, making car drivers criminals, basically. Everywhere you go, the car drivers, they're paying more and more money, congestion charge, new emission zone charge, double red lines everywhere, speed limit restrictions. So that's all gone when I'm mayor, hopefully, that will all be gone. And my big vote puller will be free public transport for all Londoners. I've got a way to finance it, so watch this space.
What does it mean to you to be receiving this honour here tonight from all these wonderful people?
First of all, I would like to say thank you to Allah. Great honor for me as a Pakistani, being a first cricketer from Pakistan and getting this award. It's a great achievement for me, and I'm very blessed. And this award goes to my family, to my Pakistani people. I'm very excited, and I'm very happy.
How important do you think events like this are in changing perhaps people's perception about what it means to be Asian, the obviously diverse range of talents and achievements being celebrated here tonight?
That's a great, I think it's a great platform to bring everybody together. Bringing those kind of awards from Asian, you know, like this society, this country is all about to bring everybody in the same platform. So I think this awards, not only for getting like me from Asia, from Pakistan, but you know, like this society is welcoming everybody. So I think this platform is a great platform to bring a unitedness together.
I think for Pakistan it is such an exciting time, obviously a resurgent film industry and sport, obviously always a success for Pakistan. When you look to the future of Pakistan, what are you most excited about yourself? What gives you the most hope for the future?
Inshallah, it'll be a great future for Pakistan because our Prime Minister Imran Khan, he's making a lot of difference. You know, like our sports is getting better because all the international teams and all international places start playing in Pakistan. So the peace, the confidence of people, you know, coming into Pakistan and playing cricket in Pakistan, and also film industries, you know, like the people are moving forward now. So I think Pakistan culture, Pakistan country is getting bigger and bigger, and inshallah you'll see they will compete internationally.
I guess my final question, obviously, in terms of Pakistan cricket, when you look at that next generation of stars, are there particular players that you are most excited to watch who you think could be the future of Pakistan cricket?
There's a plenty of them, like I say, you know, like Babar Azam, you know, like Husnain, you know, like Amamul Haq, Fakhr Zaman, you know, like all those guys, Sarfaraz, you know, those guys are very, very talented cricketer, Hasan Ali, I can name all of them. Those are young people, you know, bring lots of success for Pakistan, and they are very exciting cricketers to watch.